what it means. What it means kind of, I immediately thought For What It's Worth. You know, it seemed like a very timely song that was...
And what's going on,
That's what I mean. For What It's Worth, what's going on? And it's the great line, you know, if you think it's not racial, it probably means you're not black.
Right.
I'm misquoting that or something. But, I'm trying to think.
You know, the sad thing about that song is I wrote that song before... It's the oldest song on the record, I'm pretty sure, you know. And when I wrote it, it was so fucking timely, you know. And I really, nothing would have made me happier than to just leave it off the record for being kind of obsolete or it being, you know, and the fact that it's...
It bothers me that you can release, you know, an album or plan to release an album and be confident that it'll still be just as timely by the time it comes out. I mean, in the way things move today, mm-hmm. you know, the way everyone's attention jumps from one thing to another. I remember I read something one day and texted him and was like, enough has happened since we finished mastering this that we could write the whole album again based on completely different sources of inspiration.
You could write new verses to that weekly, it seems.
It bothers me. Mm-hmm. You know, it should bother you.
I know you're saying there's more that's happened since, but these are still recent enough that it's a very sad song, a very scary song.
You know, as Ferguson was and Trayvon Martin had those incidents had just happened when I wrote the song. And there was an aspect of that song that I'd been thinking about in terms of like something to write about, something I just kind of needed to get out of my system but didn't know how to for about 18 years. And, you know, when I first moved to Athens, there was an event like that happened in, you know, sweet, liberal, peaceful, beloved little Athens, which I love so dearly. And I lived on Ruth Street when I first moved to town, and there was an older, you know, African American lady and her son that lived across the street. And he was challenged. He was probably working on about a, you know, seventh or eighth grade level, mm-hmm. and he was grown. And they were deeply religious, and she was always out working in her yard. And so we would always wave to her because we were right across the street when we'd come and go, you know. And she was friendly, and we'd see him every now and then. And he one day the Lord told him to cast aside all worldly things and spread the word of Jesus. And he interpreted that as take off your clothes and run downtown and tell everybody about the Lord. Mm-hmm. And he got shot numerous times, you know, unarmed, naked, and because a naked black man is a threatening thing, you know, in our society. And he was shot like seven times and something like that. And, you know, in front of kids, in front of school children. And I mean, it was horrendous, you know, and there was a big stink and a big hoorah.
One had a camera to film it or
you know, he charged me, you know, he didn't charge you. He was exuberant, you know, because he had a, you know, he had
someone who tries to, who has to settle disputes among young boys, and try to get to the truth. It's like, I hear some of this stuff and I'm like, okay, so you shot him because he tried to get your gun. Is it the same gun you shot him with? Mm-hmm. Okay, obviously he didn't get it. He was 10 feet or more away from you when you shot him. So let's go back. He was trying to get your gun. You prevented him from trying to get your gun. He was that far away from you and you shot him. Well, he was running at me. He was coming back at me. Okay, but you said you shot him because he was trying to get your gun.
Right.
You know, it's okay, give me all your electronic devices and go to your room until you're ready to come back here with something that sounds like the truth. And, you know, we'll talk. I mean, that's how I feel, yeah. You know. If it sounds like bullshit, it probably is.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I'm sorry, I'm a grown man.
Once they banned Imagine, I forgot about that, and then I looked it up. I said they banned Imagine. I thought they banned it.
It wasn't banned. It wasn't banned.
It was recommended not to play
by your boss. if you happen to work in one of those radio stations.
Yeah.
Yeah. It wound up on that list. It was a long list. It was a really
huge.
Long list.
There's a Wikipedia. I looked it up, and what came up was the Wikipedia list.
I'd wanted to write that for a long time, and I finally ended up stumbling on what I needed to stumble on to do it. But yeah, the absurdity of thinking that might not be what America needs to hear after 9/11. No religion, too.
Yeah.
Imagine none of this bullshit.
It's,
was there.
Well, it's interesting that the idea is...
But the idea of the song is how it's always the same people, no matter what we're afraid of, no matter what we're declaring war on, whether it was the Red Scare or the Black Panthers or the war on drugs or the war on terror or the war on this. Or it'll always be the same people that are to blame.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what, you know.
Is it heartening at all that they went after, like, they seem to think that music has this power, right? To, So.
And it does. I mean, there is a power to it. You know, it may not, you know, it may not divide the waters, but it definitely, you know, some change is an incremental thing. I mean, it's not going to, you know, people are still waiting for some Messiah to come and wave their wand and make it okay, you know. And it's you know, it's like, you know, I'm so disappointed in Obama because there's been a lot of change.
Yeah.
It's slow and it's tedious, and sometimes it's, you know, it's like making sausage and you don't want to look, and it's kind of gross, and it's, you know, but it's still, we are moving in right directions.
Yeah,
we're just moving really slowly.
There's actually a lot to be hopeful and positive about. That's how I want to end it. If there's an ending to this whole thing, is that there's actually a lot to be hopeful about if we just don't fuck it up too bad before we get there.
Yeah.
You know, that's what we got to try to not. You know, it's not what you do, it's what you don't do that matters. Let's just don't fuck it up.
Yeah. My family's all insured now. You know, they used to not be because we had pre-existing conditions in my family, and so there were, you know, one to two at any given time that I couldn't get covered.
Sure.
Right out, and it's terrifying, you know, and that's speaking as someone who's blessed enough that I could actually afford barely the monthly payment to insure them, and I couldn't get anyone to write it because of their pre-existing conditions, and that's a huge change in my family, in my personal life, you know, and so
it's all about just, you know, holding, being consistently holding bullshit up to the light of reason, and it gets heavy.
Yeah,
it gets heavy, but that's when people stop believing bullshit, things get better, no matter what those things are.
We're at Baggage, which is the word I keep bringing up, but that's actually a song, I guess, about mental health.
Yeah, you know, our band's pet cause for pretty much almost the whole life of the band has been Nucci Space. And which is just a microcosm of a bigger thing, but it's, you know, it's suicide prevention. And I wrote that song the night Robin Williams died. And again, it's a beautiful sunny day where I was when I heard the news, you know, and I'm like, God damn, you know. And you know, I never met him. I was, you know, everybody loves Robin Williams, but I mean, you know, I wasn't like an uber fan. I didn't memorize his stuff, but it was just so sad, you know. It's like, goddamn, you know. It's like, you know, he's brought a lot of happiness to hell to me and so many people, you know. And he couldn't find his way out, and it's sad, you know. And we've all lost so many friends to that. And and over and over, and you know, always will. And I guess it was, and I'd just kind of come out of a pretty dark time in my own head anyway. Mm-hmm. And so, And so it just kind of came pouring out. I was actually at the Manhattan in Athens, at the Manhattan bar when I
wrote
that.
Oh, yeah.
And it was like greatest little bar in the world. But I was sitting outside and just wrote it down.
Cool. Yeah. Well, I want to do one more thing, which is I want to, and this isn't binding, but I want to hear each year's favorite songs by the others. You first. What's your favorite Cooley song on this record? If you had to pick one now, which you can change your mind tomorrow.
Oh, I keep going back to Ramo because I love that song. First time I heard it, I was like, ah, man, that's one of my favorites ever. And I'm a big fan, so I generally like all the songs he brings in pretty much. But that one, you know, that one's it's fun to play. It's fun to hear. I like it.
It's funny you mentioned The Clash because I thought of The Clash when I heard that song.
I was thinking of it when I read it.
Well, that's a pretty good place. How about you, Mike?
I really don't have a favorite, but I'm pretty partial to Ever South on this record because, you know, much has been written about trying to, you know, unlock the mystery to our culture and what makes it what it is, what makes it tick. And everybody gets back to about the Civil War and it was about slavery. No, it wasn't. Yes, it was. No, it wasn't. Yes, it was. And then everybody forgets what they were trying to learn more about in the first place. That at least plows on back to the immigrants that and the deeper history behind that. And I think that's important to try to understand.
I thought that was really cool too. That because you know you're right. Like you never think about well how did everyone get here?
Yeah, the people who actually settled it and how they were they were rejected by the Irish.
Right.
At the time, you know, they were the unwashed, they were the unwanted, and that suspicion of the outside world was just,
Right when I wrote that, we'd been in town about almost 6 months, about 5 months, and in Portland, and my family was really crashing and burning from homesickness. I mean, it was like, that was the point where it was really coming to a head, you know, where everyone's excitement about the new had just worn off enough to where the reality of, you know, grandma and grandpa are on the other side of the country.
And we've done that so many times for so long, we're numb to it.
Homesickness is something, that's just part of my makeup. You know? But, you know, my wife has never lived more than an hour and a half away from her parents, you know, and my kids had never lived anywhere but Athens, Georgia, and you know, and they're all just like, we're at that point where they're all crashing and burning. And one night we had a sitter, and Rebecca and I went and saw Brooklyn, and which is about the Irish girl, and she comes over, and you know, and falls in love, and kind of gets really homesick, and kind of has an adventure, and then she gets called back, and you know, and it was incredible. I thought it was such a great film, but it so hit home at a very emotional level, you know, to my wife and I, and what we were going through. And I came home and I actually started writing it that night. I wrote like the first little bit of it that night, and then I just kind of hit a wall and I went to bed. I was smart enough to leave it, and for once. And then the next day I woke up and it was just still going in my head, and I sat down and I finished it really quickly, and it came together, you know, like in basically two little pieces.
Cool. The one thing I guess, since we're here, I read the thing you wrote, and I'm curious what you mentioned Between the World and Me.
Right.
And To Pimp a Butterfly, and I thought it was interesting that you mentioned those two you know, works of art.
Right.
In relation to this, I'm curious how those two.
I mean, that was a big part of my mindset for the last year. You know, both of those works of art really fit right into everything that's been happening, and in a way that, you know, we're sitting here in electric land, you know, and we think about how the records in the 60s captured that moment in time of all this tumultuous change and all that. And I mean, to me, To Pimp a Butterfly is one of those records. I mean, it's in the grandest sense, it's a London Calling record. It's a it's going to be one of the very great records of the decade, if not the greatest record of the decade. And that book, a similar type of thing, you know, and they're kind of connected. They're kind of, you know, unintentionally connected.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
It's sure fun to get to see you again, man.
Yeah.
It's fun. It was fun.